I've made a ton of mistakes in my life. A ton. So many I can't even keep track of. And just because I'm a certified financial planner doesn't mean I haven't made any financial mistakes. I've probably made as many financial mistakes as I have personal mistakes. True story. Hashtag true story. Do you know what's even worse than making a mistake? It's having a regret. Today I want to highlight 10 financial choices that you'll regret guaranteed in 10 years. Let's take a look. The first regret that you're gonna have is not starting a budget. Now, if you listen to anything that I put on the web, whether my videos or my blog posts, you'll know that I hate budgeting with a capital H. I hate it. I hate it. Because if you're like me and you hear the word budget, you just say, oh, budget again? Will you just shut up about this budget nonsense? I know budgeting is so boring. It feels so restricting. Nobody wants to do it. And guess what? Nobody is doing. It's reported that 30% of Americans do not have a budget or any type of financial plan. But guess what? It's also shown that those that do have a budget are more likely to succeed financially. So if you have a budget, if you know where your money is going every single month, the majority says that you are going to make it financially. So why wouldn't you have a budget? And if you think that budgeting are complex spreadsheets, think again. There are so many tools and apps out there that make budgeting simple. One of my favorite software programs that you can use is Mint.com. And guess what? It's free. Mint allows you to aggregate all of your payments, all of your spendings, and put that all into one place. Now, if you want something a little bit more robust and to actually have more of a net worth tracker, then take a look at Personal Capital. Personal Capital will not only track your spending, it'll also look at your investment portfolio to look at your returns, how you're allocated, and give you a true net worth picture. And just like Mint, it's free, so you have no excuses. The second regret you're going to have is not paying off your credit cards, especially from month to month. It's reported that the average American has over $16,000 of credit card debt and is paying more than 18% in interest. Did he say 18%? That's right, 18% in interest, which equates to almost $1,300 a year that Americans are paying on interest on credit cards. I don't know about you, but why would you want to give $1,300 away to the credit card company? That's your money. Keep it in your wallet. Spend it on what you want to spend it on. Or even better yet, if you just want to throw $1,300 away, give it to me. I'll go on vacation. I'll buy some In-N-Out burger, a lot of it, and have a lot of fun with that money. You know, better yet, just pay it off. Pay it off. Be done with it. Now, I'm one of those odd financial planners where I don't hate credit cards. I actually use credit cards every single day. We have credit cards for our personal life, we have credit cards for our businesses, and we use those credit cards to get reward points. So whether we're traveling and we need airfare, hotels, whatever that might be, we rack up those reward points and we cash them in. But be very careful because you don't want to get in that trap of paying $1,300 a year of interest on nothing. Instead, use that money for yourself and your family. The third regret is going to be buying any financial product that you have no understanding of what it is and you do no research on it. Let me give you an example. A few years ago, I had a new client come in. This client had bought an annuity. When we asked this client how much they were paying on this annuity, they weren't really sure, but they gave a guess of about $50 per year. Now, we knew that it was more than this, but we just wanted to see what they thought that they were paying. Turns out they weren't paying $50 a year, they were paying $3,500 per year on this annuity product. Yes, that's a 3,500, $3,500. Now, I wish this was the only instance that I had of somebody buying a financial product, buying some sort of investment where they had no understanding, had no clue what they had. But this is not an isolated incident. We see this happen all the time. People, investors buying some product that they don't understand, and they're putting all their trust into this advisor, AKA shady salesman, into buying something that they don't understand and is not right for their situation. Before you buy any financial product, any investment, do your research, do a background check, get second opinions, make sure that you understand what you're putting your money into. All right, the fourth regret is neglecting your freedom fund. Now, you may have never heard of the term freedom fund. What that is your emergency fund. So this is your cash savings. This is what you put away into a safe place, into your savings or checking account that allows you and it gives you the freedom to not be stuck in a job that you hate, to not be able to do things that you want to do, like travel and enjoy some time out with a loved one or your family. It's reported that 19% of Americans have zero money saved. They have nothing in cash savings. And it's also reported that 31% have less than $500 saved. I can't tell you how many times I've come across somebody that is in a job that they hate, a boss that they hate, or in a living situation where they can't get out of it because they have no money saved. They have no cash to fall back on. And that's why it's so important to build up this freedom fund so that you're not trapped in a situation that you don't want to be in anymore. When you have enough cash on hand, that gives you the freedom, that gives you the power to make choices on your own, not being subject to somebody else's rule, somebody else's dictatorship, and where they tell you what to do. So don't put yourself in that situation. Build up your cash savings, have that freedom, have that choice to where you can do what you want. The fifth regret is buying a new car. And if you know me, I hate car payments. I hate when somebody tries to convince me that they have to buy a new car because they need reliable transportation. Check this out. Reliable transportation does not equal a brand new car. There are plenty of used cars that you can drive that are still reliable.
Oh, look. Oh, aren't you beautiful? Yeah. Yeah, you like that, don't you? Yeah, you're a bad little car.
A recent study showed that the average new car payment is $499 per month and it's financed over 68 months. So that means that if a 25-year-old is trading in a new car every 3 years, where they're always making a car payment for most of their adult life, they're gonna pay almost $180,000 in car payments over their lifetime. $180,000 just in car payments. Imagine if you took some of that car payment and invested it. Or what if you actually drove a used car and used that car payment and invested all of that? I think that the number one wealth killer among Americans right now are car payments. I see so many people having car payments of $300, $400, $500 or more per month, and that doesn't include insurance and everything else that goes along in taking care of that car. All that money could be used to boosting up your freedom fund, to investing that to where you can get out of your job early, travel the world, do the things that you want instead of sunking that in into a stupid car payment. All right, number six is trying to be a do-it-yourself investor when you have no idea what you're doing. Now, most people will say, well, go out and buy a Vanguard index fund. And sure, that can make sense for a lot of situations, but it comes to a point where when you have to start planning your retirement income distributions, when you have to figure out how much do you need in retirement, and do you have enough to last you? Are you taking the appropriate amount of risk? Index funds don't always work in those situations. It's a lot more complex than that. And here's another example. I had this guy that had about $500,000 portfolio that pulled it out before the 2008 financial crisis. So he saved a lot of money because he did not go through that bear market. But now I asked him, okay, when did you get back into the market? When did you know when it was safe to get back in? And this was 4 years after the market had already recovered. Do you know what his response was? His response was that he hadn't got back into the market yet because he didn't know when the right time was. He was too scared. Now he did an amazing thing, timing that market to where he got out before the crisis hit. But then he had all this cash on the table that is just sitting there making nothing, making almost zero interest because he doesn't know how. He doesn't know when. He doesn't know the right time. It doesn't always make sense to try to do things on your own. It doesn't make sense to be a do-it-yourself investor, especially when it comes to retirement planning. When you're younger and you have 10, 20, 30 years to allow that money to grow, sure, that can make a lot of sense. But when you get older, trying to be a do-it-yourself investor is like trying to diagnose some medical condition by going to WebMD.com. That doesn't always work. And if you were my doctor, would I want you to go into WebMD to give me a diagnosis before you give me a surgery? You better back off right now. Absolutely not. And if you still don't want to listen to my advice, just do me this favor, pretty please. If you're going to try to be a do-it-yourself investor, Get a second opinion. Have somebody else look at your portfolio that knows what they're doing, just so that you have a second opinion, a second set of eyes to make sure that you're not making any stupid decisions. Number 7 is thinking that important insurance policies are lame. And I get it, most insurance, it's lame. I hate paying money on insurance. It just seems like it's a waste of money. But there are certain insurance that you have to have that are super important, especially if you have a family to take care of. Like me, I got 4 kids. That's a lot of kids. Don't worry, we're done. We have no more kids. There are many important insurance policies to consider. The one I want to talk about today is life insurance. I see so many young families that for some reason don't think that life insurance is important. And it's reported that over a third of Americans have no life insurance whatsoever, or if they do have life insurance, they have a very small policy through their group plan, through their employer. Now, I guess having some life insurance is better than nothing, but let me tell you a quick story about a friend of mine I was talking to that had 2 young kids, a wife that was a stay-at-home mom, and he was the primary breadwinner. He was making over $100,000 a year, and you know how much life insurance that he had? $10,000. He had a $10,000 life insurance policy. Sure, that would cover his burial if something happened to him, but what about his kids? What about his wife? What about their house, their cars, college, the rest of their future? $10,000 is not going to be anything for them. And when we just had this discussion, and just when I tried to paint that picture of why life insurance was important, especially for his family, if something happened to him, he finally started to get it. But there are so many that don't get it. And the number one reason why people don't buy life insurance is because they think it's too expensive. Too much? Too much? Are you serious? Are you serious? Don't be talking about too much. It ain't expensive. It's not. You can get a $250,000 policy for around $15 to $20 per month. Do your research. There are plenty of online quoters that you can get a free quote to find out how much life insurance it is. It's going to take you maybe less than a minute to figure it out. So stop giving me any excuses about not buying life insurance, that it's too hard to find out, that it's too expensive, because you know what that is? Now that is lame. Number 8 is treating your retirement like a distant second cousin. What is it about retirement that people just don't think that they need to save anything? As if like this retirement magic fairy is going to appear and boom, retirement money. Check this out. There is no retirement fairy going to show up. They don't exist. And if they do, let me know. Send them my way. But the reality is that my generation and those younger than me, we're not going to have Social Security. We're not going to have pensions like our grandparents have and some of our parents have. Any money that we have that we're going to need for retirement is on us. So if we're not putting any money away, if we're not saving, if we're not investing, we're going to have nothing. And it's currently reported that over 42% of Americans don't have enough saved for retirement. So we know it. We know we're not saving, but yet we do nothing about it. I don't care if it's starting with your 401k or doing a Roth IRA or investing in some online brokerage. You have to start saving something. And if you're saving nothing right now, start saving 5% of your income. That's a great start, especially if you have nothing going, but that's not nearly enough. Your goal should be 20% of your income that you want to save every single year. Yeah, I said 20%. 20% will give you a fighting chance to retire when you want. Any more than that, and you might be able to retire early. Any less than that, then guess what? You're probably not gonna be able to retire when you want, and you might be flipping McDonald's burgers. I used to work at McDonald's. I remember how bad it was. You don't wanna do that. Number 9, and I promise you this is a huge regret, especially if you're married, is not having a money conversation with your spouse. If you don't know this already, listen up. The number 2 reason that couples get divorced is because of money, because of finances, because they don't talk about money. You have to have those open discussions about what your money goals are. One of the things that my wife and I do on a routine basis is have important money discussions. We are always on the same page, how we're going to save our money, how we're going to invest our money, and what we're gonna do with our money. And we're always talking about and making sure that we understand what each of our goals are. If you're trying to take on some financial goals and you're not communicating with your spouse, it's going to make those goals so much harder to achieve. It's also going to cause some resentment because you're not having those discussions with them. Be open, share those money goals out loud so that you can conquer those goals together. All right, the last regret is being blind to your recurring expenses. What am I spending my money on? I can't see it. What am I spending my money on? Where's my money going? How easy is it nowadays to have recurring expenses automatically coming out of your checking or savings account? We got our cell phone bill, we got satellite bill, we got Netflix. gym payment. There are so many things that we can sign up for that are going to charge us easily every single month, but don't let those stack up. You're gonna wanna make sure that you routinely check your credit card statements, your bank statements, just to see what are you being charged for every single month. We do this for our personal expenses, and I also do this for my business expenses. There are so many little things that you may have signed up for years ago that just don't make sense now. I can remember that when we started having our kids, it was a long time before my wife and I actually took a vacation on our own without our kids. And when we were looking through our bank accounts and our credit card statements, we started seeing things that we were paying each month that we really didn't need. And we started adding up how much we were being charged for this service that we didn't really care about anymore. We realized that we had enough money that we could have went on a vacation, a very nice vacation, just by stopping and cutting off these payments. It's important that you're routinely checking to make sure that you know where your money's going, that it's going towards a financial goal that is important to you right now. Be in control of your money. Make sure that you know that it's going towards something that you want to achieve, that's something that you want to accomplish and something that you're proud of, instead of some stupid payment that means nothing to you. All right, 10 years is a long time from now, but if you make some changes in your life, that if you recognize some of these financial choices that you're making, that some of these you're gonna regret if you don't start today, if you don't do something today, don't let it happen. Don't let 10 years fly by and then wake up and realize, crap, what happened? Don't let that happen. I see it happen all the time. I can't tell you how many times I've met with clients that were 20 years, 30 years older than me, and they had these regrets of not making these little subtle changes years ago. And that's the thing. These little subtle changes can have a huge impact on your life, on your financial life years from now. So don't let these be a regret. Make the change today. All right, go ahead, get started. Stop making bad choices. No more regrets. And if you like this video, make sure that you subscribe. All right, I wanna hear, what are some of the regrets that you've had? Maybe some of the regrets that you have recognized and you made those changes. Leave those in the comments below and don't forget to subscribe. All right, this is Jeff Rose from Good Financial Sense, reminding you to take charge of your money and also have some fun. Peace out. True story. 18%, are you kidding? Let me give you an example. Number 7 is thinking that insurance.